Good evening, viewers. Welcome to People and Stories. I'm your host, Jackie Narubama. And tonight, I bring you an interesting guest who's an award-winning author, a poet, a life coach, and mentor. Richard Mwewesa, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Jackie, for having me. I'm so honored to be on set today.
Okay. So, Richard, let's dive right in. Who is Richard Mwewesa? Who are you?
Wow. An award-winning author, a poet, a life coach, mentor, but most importantly, I'm also a husband, yes, and a father, yes, and the ring. Ah, the ring is here. Yes, I'm married to one female lovely wife. Nowadays, you have to be very clear and specific. Female lovely wife, yes, and I also work. My full-time job is I work as a general manager. With an insurance company called Britam, but also consult with the Insurance Training College where I teach marketing and professional selling skills. So pretty much that's my bio and who I am.
That sounds like such a mouthful. When do you ever get to relax?
There's always time. I think the key issue is that every human being has 24 hours. True. So how you use your time is very important. So it's just a balancing act. You have to balance your priorities and make everything happen according to what you love to do. I always love reading books. Being an author, naturally I'm a reader. So the Japanese, there's a book called Ikigai. Yes, the Ikigai philosophy for the Japanese says find something that you love to do, then do it well, then make sure that you find something that you're passionate about doing and do it as well with passion, but make sure you find something that the world needs, then do it and deliver it so that it may bring value to them and to you as well. So I subscribe to that kind of philosophy, and that's what gets me doing all the things I do.
How does an insurer become an author? At what point did you cross into book writing?
Well, I think for me, the background of me starting my writing journey was way back in school. In my high school, I went to Nakasongola Ame Secondary School for my A-level studies. So during that time, I used to participate as a writer to the weekly newspaper called the Weekly Herald. So I would provide and contribute articles about different subjects. So I had a friend called Richard Mosave. So we used to compete a lot with him. He would say, I'm better than you. No. I'm better than you. So we'd, week on week, would interchange articles for the newspaper. But then thereafter, I was also part of the team in the school that was responsible for providing content and the editorial team for the school magazine. So that's when I started writing. But when I joined university, I had a friend called Glida Namkasa. She's now in the US. She was a writer at the time with FemWrite. So she used to invite me a lot to a number of meetings with the FemWrite at Katikati way back. So at the time she was the Macmillan African winner for one of her books. Not necessarily, but I think she nudged me, I would say. She used to send nuggets to me to inspire me to write. So she used to overpinch me and say, Richard, you have potential. When I was at university, that was around 2003, for my first degree, she would say, Richard, you can write. You have the potential to write. You have the gift. But, you know, like when you don't see anything to write about, there's no reason. I didn't have a why at the time to write. So I packed it. But then one time she was doing research for one of her books where I was featured as a character in one of the books. So she used to come to me at Chambogu University and asked me a number of questions. As an author, you know, authors are very inquisitive people. They observe. So she used to ask me a number of questions. So there she cornered me and said, but Richard, you really can write. You have the elements of a writer. You're a good storyteller. You're into music. You're into performing arts. You can write. So I declared to myself that one day I'll write. So that's one of the resolutions I used to put down, because I write my resolutions every year from way back. So. Yeah, sure. So as an author, you have to be organized. If you're not, then you will be all over the place. Anyhow, so I wrote down that resolution and said I would write. But then I did not know what to write about, how to write, what to even say. So year on year, from the year 2003, I kept postponing that resolution. So come 2019, I was so honored to attend a conference in Cape Town, and where one of the presidents of that company that was teaching us in the conference, called Irrational Lab, said, please pick one thing you'll do by end year. Don't make any excuses. Make sure you make it happen. That was June 2019. Yes. So she said, after this training, don't do too many things, just pick only one, but make it happen by end year. So for me, it was obvious. I'd postponed the writing resolution for 15 to 17 years from when I said I write. It was very clear, as ready and ripe. So I affirmed. I went back into my room. I'm an ardent Christian, so knelt on the bed and prayed in the water, and I said, God, I do not know what to write, but I've committed, I'll write. So help me, give me ideas, and get me a coach. And wow, where there's a will, there's always a way. So when I got back, I encountered one of my coaches. It's called Pepe Minambo, is an author of 10 books. Yes. So I approached him, I told him, he has a life coach as well. So I approached him, I said, Pepe, I need to write. Help me, because you've written 10 books. I need to write. I committed and I have to make it happen. So we sat down, then he coached me through the process, and 90 days down the road, I had a manuscript ready. Yes. The rest is history.
Tell us about your first book.
My first book.
You told me, leaving Cape Town, you had to focus.
Yes.
So how did the book come to you? Some authors say the book comes to you.
Yes.
How did it come to you, the topic? Because there's so many things to write about in our
world. Yes. Thank you. Now, I think for me, the issue was, as I said, remember I mentioned about the Ikigai, the things you love to do, the things you're good at, and your passions. When we're doing the one-on-ones with my coach, something he asked me, he told me, Richard, you know what? Look at the things that move you. Yeah, as an artist, if you do not put out content that moves you, then it will not move another person. That's one. Two, once you're putting together your narrative, your story, because a story that is about you is believable. Why? Because it is your story. It's not something that is fiction or something that you're trying to say that is imagined. It's your story. So tell your story. Three, ensure that as you're telling that story, be authentic, because ultimately a book is a person. Yeah. When someone picks the book has a voice. As much as it's representing the thoughts, the ideas, the ideals of the author, in itself it's a book. So it is speaking to different people. So,
sorry, hold on right there. Let me talk about, if you're writing your story, I would naturally think it has to be authentic. It is your story. How can you fake authenticity?
There are sometimes when authors tell lies. Yes, if they may not necessarily say the truth, or they may not be as honest. They may withhold some material facts. That's why the best writing style, I believe, for books that are in the coaching element are mainly written in the third person, what we call omniscient. Yeah, because these are books that are speaking to someone. Yeah, direct, just like you, when someone reads the book, they are reading, they're having a conversation with the author. Yeah, directly. And I mean, the heart can never lie to you. Your heart will never lie to you. When you read something that is not authentic, there's something that is always true, but when you see it and read through it, it's not believable. So for me, I said, let me leave out everything. I'm not going to hide anything. I'm going to share my fears. I'm going to share my tears. I'm going to share my thoughts with the world. And I think that's how authenticity comes out in the author. Okay. Yeah.
But now, let me ask, usually everyone has a story to tell. Mm-hmm. And perhaps everyone can write. Mm-hmm. But what holds back people is the fact that they're going to share pieces of themselves. Mm-hmm. How easy was it for you to share bits of Richard with the world?
Honestly, it was not easy. Why? Because one thing I'll tell you for sure, one thing that holds back people telling their stories is fear that they will be judged by the world. Number two is they always want to keep certain things very personal and private. Then lastly, not everyone wants to be vulnerable. Yes, because as an author, if you are going to say and tell a story that is authentic and is believable, you ought to be vulnerable. There are levels of vulnerability. You say it as it is. As I mentioned, your fears, your tears, your strengths, your weaknesses, you have to tell it as it is. Because as a storyteller, one of the things you ought to be is original. The other thing, you have to be a person that can easily connect with your audience. Yeah. Then lastly, you should be a person that when people read your story, know that people will always validate what you're saying. Yeah. Some will go and investigate your story to verify as critics to see if you're really for real or you're just a person who is filled with hot air. So I think there's a lot, but I think one of the major things is fear that people will judge you. So as a writer, you have to go past those fears and put yourself out there. As I said, you ought to be vulnerable, yes, to the world and your audience.
But what is the advantage of doing that? Everyone doesn't, most of us don't want to be vulnerable. We do anything to prevent our vulnerability from coming out. Yet here you are, you pen down everything. Mm-hmm. What are the perks behind bearing it all as an author?
I'm very inspired. As I mentioned earlier, I'll not hold back saying my faith. I'm a born again Christian, yeah, so I read the Word of God so much. I read the Bible a lot. So one of my biggest inspirations has been Christ, Jesus Christ. When I look at his story, because I believe he's the best coach that has ever lived. I mean, imagine what he does. He is holding back outcasts. In his barn, on his company, he has tax collectors, he has prostitutes, he has a fisherman. Yes, he has, he has the creme de la creme of all the worst that society had seen in the time. But imagine he puts them in one place and he gets the best out of each and every one of them. Yes, and when we look after he's left, these are the people who are changing the world. They are creating a very big, a big revolution. Actually, they are creating disruption. Yes? I mean, these are people who are not known or respected by anybody, but he turns them from ashes, yeah, to grace. I mean, he gets them from rugs to people who are changing the world. So he's a very good coach. I think he's the best coach there's ever been. I've read widely, I'll tell you. Honestly, I've read philosophy, I've encountered great philosophers like Seneca, philosophers like Aristotle, I've encountered great philosophers like Plato, I've read widely about Socrates. I think he's one of the finest philosophers among all of them. But when you look at Christ's work, he's a philosopher as well, but when you look at his work and the way he did his thing, I think he was very vulnerable. If you read all the words he spoke, he was authentic. First of all, he had nothing to hide. In a poor family, a son of a carpenter, and a carpenter's job at the time was a nobody. He didn't have a silver spoon in his mouth, born in a manger. He saw scarcity growing up as a person. So the stories he was telling and all the parables he spoke as the greatest storyteller were very authentic. Yes, and original. And indeed, I believe that's why he was so believable, because he put out his vulnerabilities. Yes, as a person from Nazareth. Actually, Nathanael, one of the persons in the Bible, said one time when he was told that this is the Messiah from Nazareth, he said, I mean, what good thing can come out of there? So basically, if you look at his life, he was from the bottom of the pyramid. Yes, but he changed the world. And I think for me, that's my greatest inspiration.
Thank you, Richard. Let's go for a short break. We'll be back. Welcome back to People and Stories. We're still here with our guest, Richard Mwebesa. We understand that the Christ,
yes,
had to share all his all,
yes,
to change, to write the law and, mm-hmm, stuff and save us.
Mm-hmm.
But now for you,
yes,
your book, what, mm-hmm, did you hope when, okay, you started writing your book, your story, uh-huh, telling your story,
uh-huh,
what did you hope that book would do for others?
Now, I'll be very honest with you. I'm an honest person. I'm very straight and pointed. Yes. So, to be honest, I always wanted the book to impact lives. It was never about the sales. Yeah, because I knew eventually the sales would come. Yeah, if the content was good and if the book would change a life. So for my driving force to author was to tell a story and stories of others. For my first book, Out of the Crowd, because you asked, I tell about my first book. This is the first book, Out of the Crowd. And I think for me, I always had a question in me. Number one, I always, wherever I had gone, everywhere, everyone always wanted the best. If you went for an interview, you want to look for the best candidate. Yes, if you're a person who is looking for a husband or a wife, you want to get the best wife you can get. Yes, if you want to build a house as a priority, you want to get the best house in the best neighborhood you can get within your means. So the world is about the bests. Yeah, so Out of the Crowd, I was fascinated about the concept. Why is it that there are certain people who are so profoundly outstanding? Why? Because there's good, then there's great, then what is better than great? Better than great is exceedingly, yeah, or excellent. Then what is better than excellent? What is better than excellent is what they call outstanding. Something that is really outstanding is better than excellent. So the world is past getting what is good or great or excellent. People want outstanding things. So I said, fine. Who are the people who have done outstanding exploits? Is it that they are special? Is it that they are born with silver spoons in their mouths? Is it that they've gone to the best schools in the world? And when I began doing my research, I found out something very interesting. That outstanding people, as a matter of fact, about 98% of all the people I researched, over 100 people, world over, different times. I told you I researched about philosophers, those I've earlier mentioned. I researched about music, I researched about science, scientists, the likes of Isaac Newton, Albert Einstein, the guys that changed the world that were really profoundly outstanding. And I realized that these people were as ordinary as any person can be. They're not special, so to speak, but there are certain things they did, and when I found out all the secrets, yes, I made each secret a chapter in the book. There are 7 chapters in the book, yes, that these people applied to become who they became, and their stories are embedded in here. I also brought it home in Uganda. I did homework about sports people. Great people. I will not spoil it for you. You have to get the book to read and find out who are there. But I realized that these people lived in different times, different eras. But when you look at the things they did, it's almost as though they were all seated in one place and they unanimously agreed that this is what we ought to do to become who we are. So there were constants, and those constants were very visible. And those are what I put in the book.
Interesting. And the second one?
The second one is the commitment. I always want to do what I say and say what I do. And when I say something, I want to say what I mean and mean what I say. I can repeat that. Okay. I always want to say what I mean and mean what I say. Because, as I said, I'm an honest person. Sorry?
That's the COVID book?
Yes, partly. This is the book that came out during the time of COVID. Yes, so I always wanted to do what I'd committed to do 16 years ago. Remember, to Glide, I said I put a resolution. It didn't matter how long it would take, I had to make it happen. For me, that was like a debt, a personal debt that I must author and release a book. Then the third driver is a book is makes you an authority. An author becomes an authority on the subject matter they are writing about. So being a coach and a mentor, I wanted to have a reference point where people as an authority in the content, because when you're building content, the 3 C's, I believe 3 C's, your content builds your context, because the context is the story, is the so what about what you're saying, the content, it's the context. Then the context builds your connection with your audience. So once you have good content, and you tell the story well, you contextualize it, then the last C is you will easily connect with the readers or the audience. So that's the third reason. So I wanted to author so that I can affirm myself as an authority, because as a life coach, I mean, what can validate you? You're always referring to other people's work. But then what are you saying in your exploits or in your exposures? Three is again, I think, last reason.
Life coach.
Yes, the three is. The first is education. Yes, when you I'm not talking about education in the context of going to school, universities, no. Because there are people who've not gone to school, but they're educated.
True.
In which way they've learned through life. Life teaches them lessons. Society teaches them, seen people, they've never been to school, but they run businesses very successful. Actually, they apply and they have empires, and these empires are very successful. So the education is in the lessons learned through the process of life. Growing up, observing my parents, observing my relatives, friends. Then the second E is the environment. Similar, because your environment can also become your trigger or classroom or nudge. It can sharpen your character, it can sharpen your behavior, depending on how you relate with your environment. It can teach you and sharpen and shape you. Then lastly, the E is the exposure. Yeah, exposure is how wide you've seen things, the way others are not seeing or seeing them. Yes, for example, someone can say, I'm wearing a shirt, it has a yellow pattern, but when someone else looks at it in terms of the exposure, they may see a pattern for a skyscraper or a design. So that exposure, yes, gives you that other element to see things in a different way. Yeah, so those three E's as well became my fourth reason to write. That when I put out my story, number one, will it provide education? That the lessons I learned through what I saw, through my eyes as the author, the lenses of my eyes, or will it create an environment that I have not seen or someone has seen in a different way to give them context for different perspective as a story? Then lastly, the exposure, because it said exposure, you can go to New York by not going there, by reading a book.
Sure.
Yes, so I wanted to have that element that can someone see a mirror or a screen, yeah? Through the pages. That was my driver.
Now, since you're a manager, I say,
yes.
You're a manager. Now, I'm wondering, before, if you have any trouble, say, with your employees, maybe one is being a little, a little off, does the life coach within you rise to think that I won't act, I won't play the managerial part, I'll instead let Richard the coach.
There's never conflict, because the issue is that I am one and the same person. Now, one thing I love about the coaching aspect is because the best managers or best leaders, if I should use the word leaders, ever are those that have a coaching perspective. Now, who is the coach? There's a difference between mentorship and coaching. Maybe I provide context on that. The mentor is the one who teaches another by showing them the ropes of what they passed through. Now, a coach is different. A coach may not have gone or done through what you did, but he has that exposure. I'll still go back to the ease. That exposure that is different from what you've done. So he's seeing from the outside. So he's noticing and observing the things that you are not doing right, or you ought to do right. So what he does as a coach is he scans the environment for you. Yeah, then he looks at the key elements in the environment. Then he says, these elements, I can use them to advantage, or they can become my disadvantage. They can become my threats or my opportunities. Yeah, then what the coach then does is he will use the strengths or the key qualities of the employee or the person to help them be aware of these elements so that they can leverage them to be the best version of themselves. So that's why I say a leader or a manager who has a coaching perspective is always the best manager. Because one, I'll talk about the word BEAT. I love acronyms because they are easy to remember. BEAT, yes, yes. The B, earlier I talked about it, believability. Everything you do, be authentic so that you're believable. Yeah? Then the E stands for empathy. Yes, as a coach or as a leader, you ought to be empathetic because you wear the shoes of the other person. You see where they're failing, you see the other side of story and help them improve. Then the A is to always have aspirations. Yes, because if you don't subscribe to something better than yourself, better for tomorrow, then you will never grow. So coaches help people grow through aspirations. So they set goals and they set priorities and they agree on them well. Then lastly, the T is transformation. If you're a person who doesn't transform others, then there's no growth for yourself and others. So the beat.
Okay.
Yes, that's
so
it.
So you apply that even at work?
Yes, every day.
Okay. Yeah. Then you make a good boss. Haven't you won boss of the
year? No. I don't know about that. It is said bosses are bosses, but I believe I'm trying. That's all I can say. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you very much, Richard, for visiting us on People and Stories. That
Thank
has
you.
Been our guest tonight, Richard Barossa, a prolific writer, nascent though, with 3 books to his name, an award winner, a mentor, a coach, and
a poet.
A poet. Yeah. Thank you very much. Good night.